I think we're going to stand safe.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, I will call the meeting to order. The first thing we're going to do is we have the open public forum where we give anybody that would like to speak about something 2 minutes to talk. But I also want to let you know, when we get down to the business of Shelter Law Office, we are also going to do the same thing. For anyone that would like to comment on that, we're going to give you an opportunity to open public forum and then have a follow-up question if need be. I also want to let you know that we have invited Roxy Trexler and Gary Krugel to the meeting. Roxy had a prior meeting, and Gary Krugel wasn't sure if he's going to be able to make the meeting or not, but thought it would be 7:30 or later. So I am going to hold that off until we give him an opportunity to come to the meeting. So I just want everybody to know that ahead of time. So again, I'll open this up to public forum. Is there anyone that has anything else they would like to speak about? If not, we're going to move on and establish the agenda. I'm going to start with Don. Do you have anything to add?
No, sir.
Okay. Pete?
No.
Julie?
No.
No, Mr. Mayor.
No.
Jenny? Okay. Then I'll entertain a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved. Second.
Boy, that's Pete and Julie.
I woke those two up.
We have a motion made and seconded. Is there any further discussion? If not, proceed to vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries. We have the consent agenda. Everybody get a chance to look at the meeting minutes from the regular meeting, work session, claims for the month, advertising, the advertising for claims to the city boards, and construction projects. Everybody, if anyone has any questions, if not, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Motion made.
Second.
And seconded to approve the consent agenda. Is there any further discussion? Any further discussion? If not, we'll proceed to vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries. We're now going to open the public hearing, and I am going to hand this part of it over to Brian.
Good evening.
Good evening.
It's not coming out.
I put together a PowerPoint presentation to kind of go over the project. I guess kind of just review what the project was about, and then also to go over the assessments at the end there.
We can't go to war with the computer.
Oh, it went off, that's why.
There you go. Watch this. This is excellent technique.
Highly technical.
Jenny gets her
in the army, we had those. They were $10,000 each.
Not just for Halloween anymore.
It was on before.
I know. It was on for too long.
It is going to be one of those nights. Yeah.
Yes. Mark's already on it.
He's got it. Thanks, Mark.
Thanks for asking, Gordy.
Gordy, why don't you help her out?
There we go.
I don't want to show her what to do yet.
Okay, so you can go to the next slide, Jenny. So as everybody's well aware, the project mainly consisted of A Street from Main Street to Brown Street. It was basically a full street reconstruction with utilities, and then there was also some subsurface drainage added to the road, which wasn't present in the existing road, and that partially acts as drainage for the road base, and then also an outlet for people to use for their sump pumps so that water isn't getting into the sanitary sewer. You can go to the next slide, Jenny. So basically what was there before we started the project.
Can't hear.
We can't hear.
So basically what was there before we started the project. was sanitary sewer that was started in the night, or was installed in the 1950s. The city had identified some INI inflow and infiltration problems, basically with the sanitary sewer system, and they've been trying to do some projects to help alleviate that. So what was done first was the east side storm sewer, or sanitary sewer interceptor project on the east side that ran along the county ditch. Then in 2015, the first leg of the A Street project was done, and then this is essentially a continuation of those improvements. Some things that were seen with the existing sanitary sewer, it was televised in 2014, and there were some things found in there that were some cause for concern, offset joints cracking, sagging, and then also some observed INI as a result of those, some of those defects. Then there's also in one spot some stagnation or water sitting in the pipe up to half that pipe, so there is essentially only half the pipe capacity that was available. And if you go to the next slide, you can see kind of what that looked like. So that was from the televising tapes that the city had done in that area. Next slide. The water main that was in the project area was installed in the mid-1950s, so it's getting up there in its design life. It was all 6-inch mains originally, and that's 6 inches the minimum size, but generally, I guess a rule of thumb is to have 8-inch mains, because then you can provide for fire suppression and then also maintain some residual pressure for other things. Next slide. The existing storm sewer that was in place served about 95 acres. It was undersized by today's design standards for, and then also for what the city is designing to these days, the 10-year storm event. And then also some other problems with that storm sewer was, it was very shallow on the west end of Brown Street. It was causing some, what I would call telegraphing of the pipe. It was causing the asphalt essentially to kind of buckle over that pipe. And if you go to the next slide, I think it'll show that. It's maybe kind of hard to see in the picture, but that's kind of that longitudinal crack there is where that storm sewer is really shallow, and was kind of causing some pavement issues there. As far as the existing streets go, the city did do a pavement management study in 2011 that was used to evaluate the condition of the streets. Half of the project area was found to be in fair condition, which put it in the lower quarter of all the streets within the city. And then the other half was still in very good condition. And then, as I mentioned before, the existing roadways did not have any subsurface drainage, which helps reduce frost action because it takes that moisture out of the road section itself. So as I mentioned before, the project included basically a full street reconstruction and utilities, and then also replacement of the curb and gutter, and then also the addition of subsurface drainage. So what was done in the project, as I mentioned before, the east side sanitary interceptor project was done in 2010, and that ultimately provides an outlet for this project in conjunction with the 2015 project, which extended or upsized the sanitary sewer in 8th Street in that section. And then this project, as I mentioned before, kind of continues on with those improvements. The existing 8-inch sanitary sewer in 8th Street was replaced with a 12-inch sewer. The depth was also increased fairly significantly, which is what is the main reason why the whole entire street needed to be replaced. Because of the depth, the trench width gets so wide that essentially you'd have to replace the whole road. And then also in conjunction with that, the service lines were replaced through the right of way. And that's just to illustrate, I guess, how deep the sanitary sewer was. The water main improvements, as I mentioned before, the existing 6-inch mains were there, and they were replaced with 8-inch mains. As I mentioned before, for fire protection, you'll have increased water quality with the new pipes. And then also, it should provide for some better residual pressures if there is a fire happening and they're pulling off those lines there. Services were also replaced. Oh, that's fine, Jenny. The services were also replaced to the right of way. And then there was also a new hydrant added along the street, and then in addition there was added on to the project later, there was two hydrants. One was brand new that wasn't there before on Brown Street further south, and then the hydrant at Highway 19 and Brown Street was replaced also.
They did it three times.
You can move forward, Jenny. The storm sewer improvements, as I mentioned before, the city now, at least on the last few projects, we've been designing to a 10-year rainfall event, which is essentially a 10% chance that storm will happen every year. Off the top of my head, I believe that's a 4.2-inch rainfall for this area. So basically, the storm sewer is upsized to 60-inch from Main Street to Nicollet Street, 54-inch from Nicollet to Redwood, 42-inch from Redwood to Brown, and then the connecting pipes were upsized to accommodate future improvements and future extension of the storm sewer. And then, similar to the sanitary sewer, it was lowered in order to provide for some opportunity in the future to maybe extend the storm sewer and to provide better service, essentially, for the upstream area. Oh, that's fine. It was just a picture. The street improvements, the streets were placed to essentially the same exact dimensions that it was before the project. The pavement section consisted of 3.5 inches of pavement, 5 inches of aggregate base, 12 inches of sand subbase, and then a geotextile fabric, and then subgrade preparation. The curb and gutter was replaced, and then the bituminous wear course will be placed in the spring, and that's typically done so that the base course and everything, being that the utilities were so deep, we want to make sure that it goes through a freeze-thaw cycle to make sure that everything is holding the way it should. And then if not, then you should be able to tell in the wear course and get, or before you put the wear course down, and get those things fixed before you put the wear course down. That's just a picture of the project. The subsurface drainage improvements, 6-inch perforated drain tile was installed behind the curb on each side. It will help take some moisture out of the road section, and then which helps to prevent any type of frost damage to the road. And then in addition to that, 4-inch service stubs were provided for each property to provide an outlet for any sump pumps to keep that water out of the sanitary sewer. So now moving on to costs. So the total projected project costs, and I say projected because they still have to do their final payment application in the spring for that final lift of bituminous. But there really should be no issues with that, at least that I can foresee. And then that kind of breaks down how much of that $1.2 million approximately is in your sanitary sewer, water main, street, and then the storm sewer improvements. And then being that the subsurface drainage is mainly to improve the life cycle of the road, that cost is included in the street improvements versus the storm sewer improvements. These costs are based on basically as-built quantities of the project, and also the prices that were bid, or the bids that won. So the project's going to be funded through utility costs paid by the utility funds. The street costs will be partially assessed, with the remainder being paid for by a tax levy, and then the assessment process has to follow the requirements of Minnesota Statute 429. Basically, from here on out, this is the project schedule. Today we're holding the assessment hearing, and then we assume, or it's anticipated, I guess, that the City Council would pass a resolution to adopt the assessments, and then the final completion of the project will come in June, after making sure, you know, the seating is up. Being that it was dormant seated because it got past the seating window this year due to the wet conditions, it pushed the project schedule back. But then with the spring, you know, provided the grass comes up, and then they'll put the bituminous wear course down, the final completion of the project should be done in June. So how we calculated the special assessments, we did it similar to the last project, 2015 project. Where 25% of the street improvement costs, totaling a little over $113,000, are to be assessed to the properties that are adjacent to the improvements. The way Winthrop does their assessments is they do it on a unit basis, not as a frontage basis. So that means that every essentially front yard is called one unit, and then the side yard is called a half unit. And then in discussions with the city, being that it is school property and city property on the south, what was done is if there are 6 houses north of A Street, they assume that the city property would have essentially 6 units on the south side as well to kind of even out the assessment, so that more of the burden essentially wouldn't fall on the homeowners. The assessments are planned to appear on the 2018 property tax statements. They're financed over a 20-year term with an interest rate of 5%. There are some cases where the assessments may be deferred in accordance with Minnesota statute. Two of them being if the owner is over 65 years of age or older, or retired by virtue of a permanent or total disability, and if the owner is a member of the Minnesota National Guard or other reserve, military, who is ordered to active military service. And then the assessment role itself provides the proposed amounts to be assessed to each property. So there's the assessment role. You should have been provided that with the mailed notices. One thing, you can go to the next slide, Jenny. One of the things you'll notice is if you were at the preliminary hearing, the bid or the assessments did come down dramatically. They're about half, if not maybe a little less than half, than what was presented at the preliminary assessment hearing or the improvement hearing. And that's because we did receive some really favorable bid prices. We received prices that were very similar to the 2015 project, so we didn't really see much, if any, inflation in construction prices for this project. The project has been doing really good as far as budget. We're looking to come in maybe about 2% under budget. So then what that also means is in the project we built in 10% contingency, because with street reconstruction projects you come into things that you might not even know are there. It's just kind of the nature of street reconstruction projects. Sometimes you don't know what you're getting into until you start digging the road up. So being that the project stayed on track with budget so well, then that 10% contingency cost wasn't used, so then, you know, then obviously that it's not getting assessed. So that's basically my presentation. I'm not sure if there's any questions of the council or the mayor or of any residents that are in attendance tonight.
So this is open for any comments from the public.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you.
I have one comment. I've noticed several spots along 8th Street where there's water still standing along the curb, and I don't know what the cause is of it. I was just wondering if there's any problems with the gutter or the drainage.
Nope. So what those problems are probably being caused by is the final wear course hasn't been installed yet. So once that's installed, then it'll bring the pavement up to the top of the gutter line. So there might be a little bit of ponding, I guess, as a result of the wear course not being on. Or is that maybe what you're referring to?
Are you talking by the catch basins where there was still water, like on the corner?
Yep.
You also looked like there was something placed in there, some type of barrier.
Got the bags in there.
Yeah, the bags.
Yep, those are to prevent any sediment or anything from the construction project from getting into the storm sewer.
Well, I know there was quite a bit of leaves piled up in a certain spot.
Yep, so we can talk to the contractor about making sure those get maintained. Yep.
Now, there's one other comment I would like to make for whatever it's worth, but during the construction, do we need to place the area a little bit better to keep people off of the street while it is under construction? And there's no one particular time somebody went out in the street and got stuck and had to have a tow truck come and pull them out.
Yeah. Yep, and I think part of the problem there was after the first half of the portion had been done, so we had, you know, there was, I guess, room in the barriers in order for those residents to get on the street to their properties. And I believe that whoever it was must have went around the barriers.
There's a larger truck.
Yeah.
I think it was maybe a UPS or Schwann's or something.
I wasn't
saying. Are there any other comments or questions from anybody?
He paid for the deal with pizzas or anything, man.
Anybody from the council have any questions? I'm glad to see it coming under a bid for a change.
Yeah. Over. It's nice to see the assessments a lot lower than initially were.
If there are no further comments, I think. Oh, I'm sorry.
Can I admit now this assessment is due by the 15th of November, right?
If you want to pay in full.
Pay in full. Okay, when do we find out what the full amount is?
That's what's in the assessment roll. Yep.
Is this accurate?
Yeah, that is accurate.
Yep. So what was mailed to you? Yep, that would be the amount. I guess. Say that again?
Is this all we have to pay?
Yep. Yes. Now, let me preface that by saying that there were some.
Could you maybe stand up and talk?
Yep.
She can't hear you, Brian.
Yep. Yeah. There are some homeowners that.
Mike.
I was just going to say, let me preface the assessment amount.
There was some homeowners that did choose to do their private services from the right-of-way line to the house, and I believe the city's allowing that to be added to the assessment rolls as well. So if that's your case, then your assessments will be increased by whatever that amount is. But this is just basically, this assessment roll is just for the public improvements themselves.
Can you just show her exactly what hers is?
Yeah, that's what she's looking for.
Maybe you don't have a copy with you.
Yeah, she's got it.
Did she get her sewer line done?
Whatever.
Then hers is 27. What's her last name? Muller? 47.
That's all we owe.
47 on 930.
That's 25%. That's all less than all the 25%.
Yes, sir.
That's there's a water hydrant placed on my property.
Because the utilities are paying for the utility fees, so there's.
But I was just wondering why.
I'll go in tomorrow and write a check out for that.
We'll have.
By code, they have to have.
As long as they have to do the fire.
They have to have them every so many feet, and so it's easier to put them on the corners like that. It makes the spacing. Because, I mean, like farther down the street, not where you're at, there's one in kind of a weird place, because if we didn't put it there, we actually would have to put two in, and they're about $12,000 each. But you're required to have one every so many feet, and that's why one was added.
I'm glad to see that it got.
Make sure your insurance agent knows you got it. Maybe you'll get a discount.
Now I can wash my car.
You could turn it on for the kids in the summer when it's hot, right?
No, I wouldn't do that either. It's metered to your house. Are there any other questions? Did that answer your question? Okay, Beth.
Well, I guess it does, but I'm surprised.
I hope it's a good surprise.
I'm not surprised.
Yes.
I'm very thankful.
Hey, more.
Any further questions? If not, I think what we do now is we close the public meeting.
Opened
it. And then we'll vote on the
resolution.
The resolution adopted. So at this time, I'll close the public meeting, and I will entertain a motion to approve the resolution adopting the construction project assessments.
So moved.
Motion made.
Second.
There you go.
Seconded. Is there any further discussion? Any further discussion? If not, we proceed to vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Thank you.
Yep.
And I'm going to have you stay up here a second. We've got Mr. Henderson here. Talking about the, we've had a water issue that you brought to our attention. About 2 months ago, was it?
Yeah.
Something like that. Thank you all for coming to the meeting. We certainly appreciate it. And Brian had some options here. Did everyone get an opportunity to take a look at the options that he proposed? Okay, Brian, I'm just going to let you stand up and start talking.
Okay, yep, I can stand up. I maybe should have for the last one.
So basically, Jenny had called me and said there was this drainage issue, and I went out there and took a look at it. We didn't do any survey work or anything. It was just strictly just me visiting the site, taking a look, kind of with the naked eye to see what I could kind of see. And what it looks like is the driveway is essentially acting as a dam for any water that's, I guess, caught behind it on the north side. Right now, as it sits right now, there's no culvert under the driveway. And it also doesn't look like you could put a culvert under the driveway because there isn't a good enough ditch, I guess, to get the water further south to the culvert that goes under Brown Street right now. But I do think there's enough elevation drop that there maybe could be a ditch gradient in there. But basically, where that culvert goes under Brown Street, it drains into kind of a grassy area. I'm not sure. It looks like it's right away. But basically right at the end of High Street there, it's kind of tough to tell what the water does after it hits that area. I'm not sure if anybody with the city or that lives there in that area knows if that area ponds at
that,
all.
That does pond also there.
It does pond.
I think the nursing home has, I think they have problems with water too.
Okay.
I think that whole.
It affects the nursing home more than it does Sibley Estates right there too. It does have some ponding in that area.
Yeah.
Yep, so. So basically then there's kind of two options as far as helping out the water behind the driveway. It looks like, again, without surveying, it looks like there is enough grade change to just put a culvert right across Brown Street. But then that would also drain into that same low area. you know, I guess the other option would be is to put a culvert underneath the driveway and then grade out a ditch, so then the water would cross under the existing Brown Street culvert. So it kind of, those two options kind of boil down to, you know, do you want to tear up Brown Street? Because I don't believe there's an outlet on the north end, so it might make things a little more difficult for people to get in and out of there. But then I believe option two, I did provide some cost estimates. Option two is a little bit more money, but that's because you're essentially doing a culvert and you're doing, you know, some grading for that ditch. But then, you know, knowing that there's already maybe some ponding issues in that low area, I did also include a cost estimate for what it would take to extend the High Street storm sewer and then maybe put an inlet in that low area.
Does option three include?
Yep, so option one is just for the culvert under the road. Option two would be for the culvert under the driveway and the ditch grading. And then I guess option three would be, it doesn't include either option one or two, it's just essentially the cost for the storm sewer for High Street to get down to the other end. And what that would include is a manhole, a connection to the existing storm sewer running down the street, and then it's a little bit further, it's like 400 some feet, so standard practice is 300 feet spacing for manhole, so that's why there's the additional manhole there, and then you'd have the inlet.
About an option four of paving and putting the curb and gutter, which should have been done when we put all the water and sewer in.
For paving High Street all the way to Brown Street?
The Brown Street section.
Paving Brown Street.
Oh, paving Brown Street? That's certainly an option too. Yep. I guess I didn't think of that option, or I mean, we could certainly put together a cost estimate for that, but if I remember right, Brown Street, that intersection to the south, I don't believe the road is...
It's higher at the south end down by the tracks. Mm-hmm.
Yep. But I don't know if you were to pave just Brown Street in that area, I don't know if there's a paved connection to...
High Street is paved.
High Street is paved, yeah, but it doesn't go through.
It doesn't go right through.
So Grant Street.
Grant.
Yeah.
Grant.
I don't think Grant is...
Grant does not go across.
No, but it's paved up to that point.
It's paved up.
Except for the intersection. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Right, yeah.
Is so, that I mean, intersection that ours, or is that the county's?
I think it's actually split at that intersection.
What's that?
Who owns the intersection? The city or the county?
Half and half.
Is it half and half?
So, I mean, that's certainly, I mean, that's another option to look at if the city would like you to look at it.
I mean, if I'm spending $90,000 just to put a culvert in, just I think...
No, not 90, it's 9.
Oh, was it 9,000?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh,
okay. No.
Why
don't
you guess?
Unless I got my, no, commas and
carry the one, like, carry the one.
Yeah, so it'd be about 7,000 just for, or, you know, maybe 7,500 or $7,600 is what I estimated for the culvert under Brown Street, and then just under 10,000. For a little bit of ditch grading and then the other.
What I'm worried about is putting water on other people's property.
That's the problem. I'm worried about too.
Yep.
And that's why that would maybe solve my problem, but it's just passing
right.
It along. I mean,
mm-hmm. Yep.
It'd be good to get a solution to everybody's problem.
Yep, and that's why I included that storm sewer extension, you know, into that low area, because then you could put an inlet there and then, you know, maybe alleviate if there's, like you say, if there's already some existing ponding, that would take care of that too. And then it would, you know, that infrastructure would be in place. I'm not sure if the city ever has a plan to connect, you know, Brown Street to High Street, but, you know, it would be in place then if that ever were to happen. But it does appear, just based on the county parcel data, that, you know, you're draining into your own right-of-way, essentially, with that culvert that's under Brown Street. But, you know, it's pretty flat in that area, and, I mean, you know, there's not a whole lot of room for ponding, really.
If we put that street in blacktop and curb and gutter, we could drain the whole thing to the north. And since the city got that lot, we could storm sewer that to the pond.
Yep. We are. I mean, you're looking at more significant costs then.
Right.
Yeah, but then it's right.
That's what should be done.
Yeah, then it's right.
Done.
Done.
So, I mean, I'm not sure if that's something the city would maybe like me to take a look at, or maybe we certainly can.
I think that's it.
How many houses are on that street?
About six, maybe.
Six? Okay.
No, it's
seven.
You probably look
across the street, too.
Assessment each. Figure 7,000 assessment each. That's 18. 61 for the project.
Then do we want to look at more infrastructure? I mean, more look at the paving and try to take care of the problem?
Yeah, well, the sewer and the water is pretty... When that was moved off the...
That's all done.
What do you think the neighbors would think about having to pave a street? The big happy smiles on faces?
I don't think so. That's why they're...
Just ask.
Could we maybe find out what that would cost?
Find out the cost and then maybe present it?
Yeah, because you're looking somewhere between 20, probably 25 and 4, 45 for an assessment.
For, yeah, I guess without knowing, you know...
I mean, if you're going to put a street in, that's roughly somewhere in there, so...
Yeah, that's something we can look at.
I mean, I'm up for looking at it.
Put an estimate together for that, for sure.
I think maybe that's, that looks like consensus right now, just to go ahead.
Because if you get $4,000 a house, that's... So we throw 37 at it.
I have the water in my house.
We could use that money for the state next year.
Ryan, I know you were just going to take a look at it.
Jenny, we could use that $14,000 we're getting next year from the state.
Yep, I guess I didn't think of that as an option because I didn't know. I mean, it's going to be significantly more cost.
Let's take a look at that.
Right, which we didn't, right, because we took that little bit of it, yeah.
Yep, I can take a look at that.
All right, that sounds good. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll be in touch.
We're going to talk a bit now on the agenda here about hazardous building on Hennepin, and I'm going to let Don talk about that a little bit. There's been some changes in that.
So we have a situation at 415 North Hennepin Street that you can see in your packet was a letter from our building inspector that has declared that house unfit to be lived in at this time. So my initial intent for this meeting was to ask the council to adopt an order to order the property owner to take care of the situation, and then we would be, if the owner did not do so within 20 days, then we would, you would be authorizing the house to be raised. Mm-hmm. Now, that will be quite some cost to the city to raise the building and clean it up. But we're at this point because we dealt with the same issue 2 years ago. And while we improved the house at that time, it has now gone back to its previous condition. However, between the time that we were going to proceed that way, I have had an opportunity to talk with the homeowner's attorney. It is actually a good thing that she has got an attorney to help her through this process. I think we will be in a better position to really legitimately find out what she can do to improve the house, and with the attorney we'll be able to better explain the process and either come to an agreement or resolve the situation. The attorney has just come on. The homeowner has been saying that there are certain county programs available to her, such as loans, grants, things like that, that may put her in a position to clean up the house to the extent that she could start living in there and maybe get to the point where all of our concerns from the building inspector are addressed. When talking with the attorney, I told the attorney that knowing this council, I think that it's a strong possibility that if they would come and present a plan that's doable, reasonable, actually possible, that the council would be open to giving her more time to accomplish that rather than tearing down a house within the city. So the attorney has gotten consent form signed so that he can talk with the county and the other programs available to her and actually determine what is available, when it's available, things like that. So ultimately what we decided is that a decision on whether or not to order tearing down the house would be postponed 2 weeks to give time for the attorney to investigate the situation, and I'll be talking with them. If they have a legitimate plan put together, we will present that to the council so you have that as an option. but there simply was not enough time to do that tonight, and felt that you would want to have all options available to you before taking action. So the request right now would be to have a special meeting on November 20th, if at all possible, to consider what to do with that house.
I think when we're talking about something this serious, we do have to make sure that, I understand the neighbors are very upset, and I certainly don't blame them. I don't want to put up with it. When you were talking about a plan that's also sustainable.
Monitoring.
It's going to be important, and I agree that we do need to give her an opportunity, now that she has legal representation to take over.
One option that I was discussing with Councilmember Melheim before the meeting was that perhaps any negotiations should entail some sort of monitoring component where we can do spot checks to make sure that the...
Give her a goal.
That the cleanliness of the house is being maintained.
Give her a goal.
So if that's the case...
Thanks, Tom.
I agree. I mean, was there anybody here that wanted to speak concerning this?
On the... Nobody?
Okay. All right. Then I think that's what we will do. We will put it off. We will... I would like to call a special meeting for the 20th.
Yeah. Do you think that's enough time for her attorney to...
That's what he was requesting.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah, I specifically talked about that.
And we'll be good. We'll be good.
Okay.
Thanks, Tom.
So let's look at the 20th. I don't want this to go on forever either. You know,
sorry.
Let's get some resolution to it, so let's hope we can come up with something. Mm-hmm. All right, thank you.
7 o'clock?
4:30.
7 o'clock.
5:30, yeah. I'm not
so that there. Is Monday, November 20th, 7 o'clock.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to
something and then move on, or that one.
On this side?
Yeah.
The website?
No, the Anderson
thing.
It's on unfinished business.
Yeah. Oh, okay, so we're doing new business for sorry. Bringing for it.
Okay, well, as long as we have a number of people here that would like to talk about the county attorney, I see Gary is here, our representative for the county commissioner. We'll talk about the WIDA pay half the website. We'll jump back to that after this. So what we're going to do is, again, like I stated earlier, we're going to have a bit of an open forum here so that anybody that would like to say something, we're going to give you that 2 minutes, and then if you have a follow-up question after you've gotten your answer, we'll give you an opportunity for that too. So the reason we're here, talking about the Super County Attorney, if they go full-time, we would lose our local attorney in town here, and our community would lose our local attorney, and that really has myself very concerned about what that would do to our community. So we did invite Roxy and Gary, and Gary is here now. And Gary, maybe you can answer some of the questions that we have. I'm assuming most people that are out here now are here because of that. So I am going to open it up. First, I'm going to have the council give a bit of an opinion on their feelings, and then we're going to open it up to the community. Bob, do you have anything you want to say about it?
I'd hate to see it go. That's okay. The biggest thing. We lose another business in town. It was an attorney. Be my only... I don't know the ins and outs of what it's going to cost the county or what it's going to cost to do this. Maybe Gary.
My concerns are... I'm kind of a numbers person. You guys see me get a little crazy on money. When I look at what we're currently paying Shower to take care of the city and what we're going to have to pay to get somebody to replace them, we're looking at a 2% increase to our city taxes. Plus, we're going to lose how many years of experience with these attorneys that know how we work, know how we function. When we have to write an ordinance, for example, like we'll take the house thing, for example.
right now, our attorney has done this before. He knows exactly where it's filed. He knows how it was done. It takes him minutes to go get that file and update it to the current situation. When we lose that experience, now we're going to pay somebody an hour and a half to try to find it, an hour to try to write it up, and we got to pay for that in, on top of the normal, you know, the normal fees. So it's a big tax burden for the cities that are going to lose these attorneys, and I don't see where the county savings is going to offset how much the cities are going to have to pop into this thing. We're looking $18,000 to $20,000 a year more to get another city attorney to replace an existing city attorney, which is fantastic. And that's one of my major concerns with this, is the money side. Not even thinking about the loss of the ability of our citizens to go use this facility. Now, saying that, I like Dave Schauer, I like his organization, and I don't want to hold Dave back. If this is what he wants to do, you know, let him do it. But it's going to be a big detriment to the city of Winthrop.
Like Dale's point, he's talking about just the cost to the city of Winthrop. I'm very concerned about the cost to the residents of the community, not just Winthrop, but the entire surrounding community.
We're paying $18,300 now.
My thoughts are similar. I think that when you look at just the numbers for the county, I think it might look good on paper. And I'm not even 100% convinced of that. I do think the impact on the budget for the city of Winthrop and the city of Gaylord are going to be noticeable. And I think you have to factor in the citizens in the county who use Schauer Law Office. It's close by. A visit to the attorney's office is a 5 or 10 minute drive and a reasonable hourly rate. If that's gone, suddenly, you know, you might be, that senior citizen taxpayer might be saving $50, that's generous. Yeah. Let's say they're saving $50 on their tax statement. If it costs them $200 an hour more for that attorney's visit that they need, they're coming out in the negative. And I think that's a long-term loss.
Pete, do you have any comments?
I think everybody said what I mean. Pretty much, but yeah, we will totally be without a city attorney. Yeah. I mean, we will have to hire, we'd have to go out of town too. I'm not sure I understand all the buying and the selling, if I can sell my business and all this kind of stuff, what would happen. But be that it may, I've lived in this town 38 years, and I think Sheldon Larson was the attorney when I came, and Dave and Tom McCarty just opened up the office, and mm-hmm. we dealt everything with them. So it'd be kind of tough.
Now I'd like to open it up for any comments from the community.
I guess I'd like to hear what Gary has to say first.
Okay, Gary?
No,
I guess
you guys.
You're taking the commissioner's stand on this. I think it's only fair that you would explain for the rest of us the reasoning why you want to do it.
Well, one of it is that he is an elected official.
Yeah.
Okay.
He is elected, and he was at 80%. And we look at this, and this has been going on, Al, way before I became commissioner. And 2005 is some of the records when this discussion was already taking place about putting a full-time county attorney in. We, with our department head restructure, we have now have room for him to move into the facility. And I just think that is a good time to do it. Dave's gonna retire in 5 years anyway. He stated that at the workshop. So he's gonna run one more term, and he's done. So are we gonna have this discussion again in another 5 years? I mean, it's like kicking the can down the road, and it really is that. It is. 5 years. You guys are going
to
be
But at least that gives us 5 years to plan for what's going to happen within a year. It gives us time to look for some attorneys. It gives you, let Dave finish his business, the company, the way it has been. I think that's important. Why your transition is better than 1 year.
Dave might, if he chooses not to run again, that someone else might run for that position, which would leave a law office in Winthrop.
This is the problem, Julie, is that when we go to the full-time attorney, yes, he does need to give up his private practice. What we're looking for is we have a shortage right now of lawyers in Sibley County.
Yep.
I know.
And when his term goes up in 4 years or 5 years in 2022, who's going to replace him?
Yep.
That's what I've been wondering.
You know, and it is a lot easier to recruit. I shouldn't say recruit, but to get somebody in here when they know they have a full-time job
sure.
instead of a part-time job.
Makes sense.
And that, you know, there's pros and cons both ways. Dale, you know, I hear you too at the, that
no, and I like your, I like where you're coming from, so thank you.
I think that $18,000 to $20,000 cost is a little high. Jenny, can you tell me what, I have no idea what.
$18,300 right now in the contract.
Yeah, $18,000 a year right now, or $18,300.
And that's it, can I talk about the hourly rate or not?
The what?
The hourly rate?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's at $100 an hour. We're not gonna find anybody come in here for $100 an hour.
Realistically though, if it's 5 years, Gary, and we save, and Dave Shower's a pretty good guy, I work with him on our church council. If we save $50,000, the county, for 5 years, that's a lot of money.
Yeah.
So that's $50,000 a year, and that's, I think his numbers are realistic numbers. Times five, that's $250,000. And he's gonna save the county. So if everything's getting done the way we're doing it now, why do we wanna spend another $50,000, $60,000 a year to do it different?
So you've taken a look and you've seen the figures. You know, these crime rates aren't going down.
Oh, God, no.
You know, what was it, 50%, I don't, what was it in the paper? 50-some percent?
There was 5,900 incidents, investigative incidents, there's 5,900 in Gaylord last year.
And so are we being proactive or reactive? And there again, we're kicking the can down the road. You know, this is gonna happen sooner or later, guys. You know, it is. And I know that you guys probably don't wanna hear that, but that's reality.
But reality is you would probably, he would probably be hiring another attorney, whether he's 80% or 100%.
We don't know that. I know that there's something in the plans, but until that caseload gets there, you know.
Sure.
And like I said, this conversation that we had with Dave, I mean, it is a business decision.
Yeah.
And it's his business. You know, and I understand your concerns that, yes, it is going to, because I've talked to a couple of attorneys about what they charge for that. And most of them are in the $150 an hour range. I've talked to Gibbon. You know, you guys read about, what did I figure that out, about $1,525 per month on that. They're at 17 with their lawyer that they currently have. You know, you take a look at that, then it's not as bad. You know, but like I said, I understand where you guys are coming from, but I would just rather be proactive than reactive, and I can just see this thing coming sooner or later. We got to give them a year notice. I've talked to Gaylord, the mayor over there, and he said, you know, he says it is what it is. You know, he says we'll find another attorney if that's the case. I just think that they're prolonging this and kicking it down the road.
What he's saying is that he would want to continue being the county attorney, right? But what he's also saying at the same time is that he would then give up his private practice. And that affects a lot more than what we even imagine here. He's built relationships through the years. I mean, the guy fits the profile. He's honest, he's hardworking, he's very reasonable on his price, and he donates a lot back to the community. We're about to give up something that, you know, we're gonna pay a price. It's not just a price in terms of dollars and cents, or what makes the most sense here. It's a person who really has kind of given a lot to the community, and it's generations. It's not just today, it's generations of families who have transferred property, land, whatever, through the years. And now suddenly we say, oh, no, we can't do that?
Is that suddenly? Giving
well,
you guys a year.
Well, and you well, don't well, well, wait, that. Wait, you say it's not suddenly. What, why is it that we're all hearing about it within just the last month or two?
Like I said, Kelly, this conversation has taken place since 2005, before I was even elected.
Where?
In the, they can look back, because Bill Pinsky's got it. Bill Pinsky's got the newspaper articles back from 2005.
So
the conversation's already started.
If this was such a subject, seriously, then it should have been brought up a lot more than right now to say, well, simply, is this got to take place, right?
We've had two work sessions at least on this, and there was nobody on the public there.
What time do you have your work sessions?
We have them on Tuesday after our board meeting, so it'd be Tuesday afternoons, depending upon what they are.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing, Al, when you were talking about the Dave and his commitment to this community, he can still do these pro bono work for these four, I don't care who it is, they're, as long as he's the member, he can still do this without charging. That isn't going away as long as he's a member of whatever it may be, whether it's the Kiwanis, Lions, whatever organization. Banks of Columbus, whatever. You know, like I said, that's not going away. And there is the other one, and Don, you might be able to, there is a way to contract back with the county for these services, but you would not be able to do what? Is it the criminal or the civil? It's one of the two.
Well, we cannot do, once we become full-time, we cannot do private civil work. We would be able to contract back with the cities for criminal prosecution if they wanted to, but we cannot do the civil private practice.
Yep.
Jerry, how long has Dave known about this? When was he given the information?
Well, like I said, these conversations were way before.
No, I'm not.
With Dave.
I'm asking you when Dave was told this.
We've had three workshops. I've talked to Dave, I talked to him before our last workshop to find out his feeling and, you know, how he, you know, what his thoughts were. And he says, Gary, he says, I'm okay with this if we go full-time. And he reiterated that at our work session. He says, it's gonna help him, you know, in his retirement. And he says, in 5 years, I'm gonna be retired. So in 2022, after his term's done, this is what he had indicated to us.
I think you're making it sound different than what I've heard. The only thing I heard is that what he told me, and I'm pretty good friends with Dave, is that he kind of around about all of a sudden here from somewhere else, you know, that it was happening, and obviously he doesn't want it to happen that way. Actually, he's my attorney, he's our business attorney. I mean, yeah, I don't want to have to go out of town to look for one more, to lose one more business in town. I mean, hopefully maybe he could sell, we don't, I voted for you, you represent me too.
Yep.
So you're asking my opinion is that we should keep it. And that's, you know, we're kicking the can a little bit down the road, but if we save $100,000, Gary, over 2 years, that's $100,000 the county saved. And I think Dave is a pretty sharp numbers guy.
Yeah.
I don't think he would BS me. So 50,000 to 60,000 a year, if it's 2 years, it's 100. If it's 5 years, it's 250,000. I mean, if he's happy with the way it is, I'm happy with the way it is. The city's happy with the way it is. I mean, maybe we have some, maybe it is gonna change down the road, but for now, why does it have to be right now?
Where are you coming up with this 50,000?
Well, it's when you go full-time, aren't you gonna have to pay everybody more money? Aren't you going to pick up all their benefits?
We're already paying the benefits.
Mm-hmm.
That's immaterial on that. But if we're looking, we might be looking at somewhere between that eight and 18,000. But I'm going to guess it's going to fall in the middle there somewhere, probably around that 12.
So the saying here goes that it's not really necessarily about the money; it's about the timing of it. Where the county's wanting, of course, to get this now versus later, right? Is that what we're saying here?
Well, that's one of the, it's kicking the can down the road. And I understand that you guys want to prolong this 5 years. You know, crime doesn't stop. Crime's still escalating, and it will be, and it will be, and it will be.
Yes.
And so what happens if we go next year and we said, hey,
I don't think the performance of what these guys do is in question here, is it?
Is Charlotte Law Office getting everything done that needs to be done for the company?
Right now, yeah.
Yes. Okay, so then as time goes on and the workload becomes more, then we would address it.
So we end up coming back next year and we have the same discussion if it ends up escalating. Because, you know, we've got to give them a year notice, according to statute, in order for them to become full-time attorney.
I can't help but believe that if you weigh everything out, what's being said here, and we're just a small majority, there's a lot of people that are silent here yet, that are not saying anything, and I know that they're probably upset. So the point, I think, is that we're not going to be being real clear. It's about money, it's about his time, it's whatever, you know, so I'm a little bit confused as to exactly what the idea here is. Is it just because we want them to do this now versus later?
Would it be easier transitioning, keeping as is until Dave is done and retiring at that time, going with your full-time position and having the office space instead of disrupting the entire community by taking an attorney away? If the business load, if it does increase, you're going to have to hire that third time, whether it's 80% or 100%. You're still going to need that
like I said, right now with renovations and our new reorganization, we've got room to house him instead of paying the rent and stuff that we're doing right now. And, you know, regardless, I mean, I shouldn't say regardless, but what you read in the paper and some of the letters to the editor in there about where and how much this is going to cost, I would like you to go back to what Roxy's got figured in there as the administrator. And, you know, I think she's got it nailed down pretty good. And yeah, Dave has had, I mean, they've, Roxy and Dave have gone back and forth on a couple of the figures. But I think it's fair to say that she's got it down pretty good.
I think I would disagree with that. When I look at the figures that Roxy put out initially and then Dave Schauer countered those figures with his estimation of the work that he actually does and he's most aware of, his figures were very different than Roxy's. And even though the commissioners may have started talking about this topic in 2005, I would imagine that Dave Schauer was never at the table being part of that discussion with the county commissioners as the person in the office most affected by what the commissioners want to do. Even now, you had two work sessions, one in December, and that was at Dave's request. And Dave gave you a very detailed timeline of everything that had happened prior to December of 2016, when you finally, as commissioners, invited him to the table. You had another work session with Dave in August, and he again countered what your county administrator was putting forward to the board. And then in October, he basically, and you know, I think Dave Schauer's a very gracious person. I don't believe he wants to go full-time, but he also probably doesn't want to rock the boat. But if you asked him without any strings attached, he'd probably say, leave it as it is. And he even said that in the paper last week, that he would prefer to stay as is. Even if Dave retires in 4 to 5 years, he has two attorneys that work with him that are part of these communities, and I would imagine one of them will run for the position when it becomes available. So I'm not quite sure exactly what the board's thinking. It's not a good decision for the county, it's not a good decision for the cities, the community, the residents. It doesn't add up.
Well, there again, like I said.
And I have the documents, these are all public documents. I never put anything in the paper or on Facebook or say to anybody anything that isn't public information available to anybody that might want to request it. And here are the copies, the numbers, the letters, the timeline, everything that Dave has put forward to the board for their consideration.
I understand that the county commissioners will have a final say in this. It just, I think, after dealing with an attorney for so many years, she was put together after brought into the conversation sooner.
I think, too, the commissioners, excuse me, may want to be aware that there is a perception, and I've heard it from quite a few people in different circumstances, that this was sort of snowballed, that Dave wasn't a part of the discussion early on. You're right. I know that it has come up over the last 8 or 10 years, on and off. But I don't think Dave was involved early enough in the process, perhaps. And I think there's some negative connotation with that. And I think the whole reorganization of offices and things at the county is not always popular with everybody either. And I think all of that together is just creating a sense of unease about it. And I don't know how you would really address that. I mean, I like you said, people maybe don't show up for the work sessions. I didn't know about those.
You're here representing us. And if the majority of your constituents want this to stay, what's your opinion then? I mean, you're here representing us.
Well, all right, so this will probably come up for a vote, which it will. And, you know, there are five commissioners. And if I vote no for this, we still got four there. I'm going to say that are going to solely vote yes. Like I said, this has been, and like I said, I'm going back from what the predecessors had said, and I think that it was Charlie, I want to go back to say, all the way back to Charlie Wader, that ended up making this agreement where the county, or the county attorney was not housed in the, housed in the courthouse, and that they ended up, you know, paying the rent, doing this and that, and, you know. But like I said, I, you know, yes, I do represent you, and I will, and also, I guess, if I vote no, though, I mean, I, like I said, I.
Well, then you represent us then, Gary.
Yes.
So, okay, we'll take them one at a time. Then we have Joy Kors, who in a sense still is a person like myself, right on the fringe of Winthrop. And I spoke to her, but I can't help but, in talking to her, get the feeling that she really, really doesn't quite understand this. You know, she's being pulled along with it, maybe, I'm not sure. But, you know, it seems like, and if we're saying that Roxy is the one that put this together and she's the one that's running the numbers, and maybe we gotta get Roxy here.
But I'm just, explain this. When you say that she pulls the numbers, she works for us.
I understand.
You know, and she is there for the administrator to pull the numbers together.
Right.
You know, this was all probably, if you want to call it the big plan of us downsizing our department heads and also bringing in the county attorney in-house. I mean, this was all a part of that, you want to call it your planning sessions or future plans to cut down on some of these expenses. And as department heads retire, not replacing them, so that we get our you know, the department head wages down. I mean, it just, and we're doing that. I mean, it's already happening.
But here's a case that I'm not convinced that you're gonna save the money. I just can't feel that way. Until
every
it's really drawn
every
out for me,
that went up to
but I can see it better than what I see.
Every fee. And that's the, well, that's what Carver County gets.
Simple as that.
We're not Carver County.
And Gary, from my standpoint, I have to do what I can to protect our community. And this is not in the best, it certainly does not benefit our community at all. Not at this point. I don't see where it does. My standpoint is let them run the one more term. Stay as is. And then when Dave is done, make your change at that time. It gives our community time to make that change too. There are a lot of, maybe there's misconceptions out there, I don't know what it is, but there's a lot of information floating around that's not flattering to the county. And I would like the opportunity to have either you or Roxy or all the commissioners come over here and speak with us to convince us that this is really the best thing for our community. We're having a special meeting on the 20th. What do you think, anybody would be willing to come over here and talk?
I don't know what that brings up on other agendas. I have no idea. I, you know, you could probably send an email to Roxy or whatever and ask her what's going on.
I guess it would give us time to speak with our community. I mean,
well,
I think just
for
in the last
county,
couple of weeks,
you know,
people are realizing what's happening. And this is just the beginning.
This is the biggest turnout we've had in a meeting here in years.
I mean, I'm getting phone calls.
In years.
Stopping me on the streets and what are we going to do about this?
There's more people right here, than there were at the fiber meetings. And this literally just hit the paper, what, 3 weeks ago we started hearing? I mean,
yeah.
We started hearing about it. I'm not trying to pick on you. I really do appreciate you coming in, and I appreciate you answering my questions. Thank you. That was very... You answered one of the questions I wanted to ask as a taxpayer, not as a councilman, and thank you for that. But if we're getting a turnout like this in 3 weeks in the paper.
But it's not just the city of Winthrop.
No.
It is the surrounding community.
Yes.
It is the farmers that have done business with them for generations also.
And businesses.
Well, that goes back to my point. He's been here, I'm not even sure how long. But the relationship and the trust that goes with
there are more people here than there were for the library meetings.
I don't even know what to say.
Yeah, it's a big transition, and a year is not a lot of time to make that transition. And I guess, you know, from the council, I know we don't want to sit here all night. We can wind this down. Are there any more comments from the community? Go ahead.
Well, I don't really have a comment. I agree 100% with us here, we want to keep Dave here. You know, I think Gary has heard our concerns, and I don't know what else to say. I want to keep Dave here just as bad as anybody else, because he's been here. He's a great man to work with, you know, and I don't have to tell Gary nothing new. He knows that.
Yeah.
You know, and so, yeah.
And Gary, thank you for coming. Yeah. I mean, it takes a lot to come here and to listen to all this. We appreciate it. But my idea is maybe we invite the county administrator and the commissioners, whoever could come the 20th, and try to explain to us where this is, where the benefit is to the entire community. If this was to take place.
Well, I think it's important enough that if the statements are made like that, that there is an obligation on her part or the other commissioners to do something like that. You're good enough to come here. Why wouldn't we be able to do that? No? Why not? That's a question that will remain.
Give those an invite. You know, you could keep us updated when you're going to vote on it.
That's going to be in January. That's when you do your reorganization, and that's what it will be voted on, and that's what will give him his one-year notice. So if there's going to be any change,
pin him down.
Is it possible for the council to go to a board meeting?
Absolutely. Yeah, that's part of it.
Can you put an agenda for that? Maybe that's easier than getting our commissioners here.
I would say that's probably a good idea. I think that would probably work out better that way than, and you know, whatever. I just got a question. I mean, I'm just going to throw this out there. Don, do you have any interest in buying the practice? You know, you got the EDA behind you. You buy the practice, and you know, you
come on.
Put you on a spot.
That's like a hot seat for Don.
You know, Pam, I appreciate your question. My only concern is you're going to have our council can be the representative, but to come here with a house full of our community.
And to hear that
is different than for us to voice our opinion.
But you all have enough people in your community to talk to and get them to the county board meeting.
That's true.
Yep.
That's going to be a lot easier than trying to get five commissioners to a meeting here because they have so many commitments.
Okay.
So I just recommend you talk to your commissioners.
I mean, I'll take this back to them. You know, I'll talk to them. I am one vote out of five. So.
I've talked to all but one, and I finally talked to that person yet too. Again, we really appreciate you coming here. You shed a little light on it, but I think we have a lot more to say about it.
When is the next commissioner's meeting?
A week from Tuesday. And there is a work session after that, but you almost need to get on the agenda. And then they have another one, what would be the 28th?
28th is a Tuesday.
Yeah, 20th November is the next.
If you think about it.
So it's the second and fourth Tuesdays of the month.
That thing.
And I would recommend if we're going to be doing something, we do it on the fourth Tuesday, because I would certainly hope that Tuesday we would put something in there, letting them know that the city of Winthrop is inviting everybody from the community that is concerned to go to that board meeting.
Is this topic going to be on the agenda?
Keeps blowing me off.
Unless you guys.
Unless you put it on.
We can have requests on the agenda.
Okay.
The 20th.
The agenda or the work.
You guys give me on and on.
The 28th?
I would probably say the tax work session might be better.
The 28th is the fourth, that is the fourth meeting, correct? Are their second meeting?
Second meeting of that month.
I'm going to talk.
28th of November.
Want me to ask to have you, the council, on the agenda?
That's a question, yeah. Can our entire council be at that meeting?
Just post it as a special meeting that you'll be there.
We normally get out of the regular.
That covers your bases.
Yeah.
Okay.
11:30.
As a guy.
Either one or a work session, you're not taking any action.
And that change, if it's a short agenda, we don't usually have to.
He said the work session.
No, it's not anymore.
Question, the regular meetings, you no longer televise them, which I strongly disagree with, but the work sessions are not recorded, are they? I mean, they're just written, but it's not recorded.
I don't think that they are.
So would it be more effective, you know, being at a regular meeting?
You get on the agenda. I mean, I don't have a problem either which way. I mean, I like I said, if there's an action item to be had, that would be one thing. If it's a matter of discussion, I would say the work session would be the better way to go.
I think we do both. And when were the work sessions?
I think this month we got them on both board meetings, I think.
To be practical, would it make more sense to be, request to be on the work session at the end of November? And then if there's something asked to be on an, on the actual agenda following that?
The next following meeting.
I mean, I'm just trying to be most productive with everybody's time and effort.
Anybody can go into the work sessions?
Yes.
Yeah, they're public, they're public.
All right, and where are they held?
Right, the commissioner.
Okay, 28th?
How was deer hunting?
What time are the work sessions, what time is it?
It all depends upon what the agenda is. It can either be right directly after the board meeting or usually 1 o'clock. You know, if we got a short agenda and we're done by 10:30, then they'll have them right after. Otherwise, they usually, if our meeting goes to 11:30, we usually break for a short lunch and back at 1 o'clock or 12:30, whatever.
Well, if we want people, community members to know that there's a work session, they could have some input.
Yep, they can schedule that and just say you want to be on the work session at, you know, 1 o'clock or whatever, 2 o'clock, whatever. Just talk to Roxy on it and have her put you on the agenda.
Thank you.
Thanks again.
Thanks, Gary.
Appreciate you coming in.
So how did deer hunting go?
You want me to contact Roxy and request that we be put on the agenda for the work session? To discuss the full-time county attorney position, and then you're gonna, or we will make that announcement that people can come. Just so I got it straight.
So, yeah, I would like to see people from the community come into that work session.
Thanks, Brian.
Okay.
But I really hope I don't get someone for jury duty that day.
Oh, jury duty's always fun.
You'll be at court.
Yeah.
What's the date?
28th. Well, I know it's a, I have the list of dates.
Long time since I've had jury duty.
But I haven't yet.
I was even on a trial.
All right, we're gonna move on from here. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for coming up to the meeting. We certainly appreciate your input. Again, thank you, Gary, for representing.
Al.
We're gonna go back to the Rita request for the website, upgrade.
What was it costing, $500?
Oh, no. A little bit more than that.
$600?
All right.
All right. Mr. Mayor, members of the council, we started our city website in 2009, I believe, maybe late 2008. We did a kind of on the cheap, but it was effective, and we had staff do it. Excuse me. Last summer, late spring, Phil Kython, who's working with the medical school, indicated that they're going to take a new approach to not only marketing the medical school, but marketing the area. And part of that process was to elevate our image as an area and as individual communities to make us more attractive to what we think's going to come about with this medical school. And Phil has been working closely, and so has the RS Fiber, a cooperative with Lime Valley Marketing in Mankato. I know Brian, who owns a Lime Valley, and I went to see him, and we came to the conclusion that he offered an opportunity for the city of Winthrop to very cost-effectively upgrade our presence on the web, add new social media functions, add new communications functions through the digital and into technology, and our EDA agreed quickly, and because of some seasonal timing issues, we wanted to take advantage of the green lawns and the green trees, because there'll be video added to the website to go along with this, with the understanding that it's a city website, it's a chamber website, and it's a EDA website, all in three. All of the local businesses will have an opportunity to have their own spot on that website. And we would like the city to to pay for half of the cost at least. Now, the city paid for all of the cost of the first one, which was a couple of thousand dollars, I think. This one's very effective. I'm on the MMUA Board of Directors. We did a new website 2 years ago, and we're up over $75,000 right now. And it doesn't have a lot, it has a lot of the same functions we're going to have on this. Our cost for this is about $10,000.
What are some of the functions that are different on this that make it worth that $10,000?
Well, just the look and the feel, the fact that it presents our community in a more dynamic way, a more hip way, I guess. There'll be a video, there'll be videos on there, and it features the city, the chamber and the EDA, because as a community, we need to present our business opportunities as well, and we think that's been missing. So
Will there be links to the different businesses, and can those businesses do, advertising, whatever?
Yes, all of the businesses in Winthrop will be able to have their own web presence on this site, and they'll be able to have their own a web address or a link from their current site to their page on this, and vice versa. And that cost, we believe, will be free. And we're also going to provide, through a grant from the Blanda Foundation and some kick-in money from the Chamber and the EDA, business training for these businesses to have their presence on that website, and also learn how to use Facebook to develop a business presence. So we
business presence includes, they can have up to like a dozen pictures of their business,
a video,
a summary. There's feedback. You can email them questions and correspondence for each business, and then it also will have a link back if they have a different website.
So the cost is $4,800, you said?
Yeah,
total
40.
Total cost is $96, but so our share.
The businesses and that pay the other half?
No, the EDA is going to pay half of it, Pete, and we're asking the city to pay the other half. And Jenny's very interested that this website allows us to do this, to work into other social media platforms, which can become effective communications tools between your local government and residents.
Yearly cost?
It's a one-time cost. And actually, the annual cost to host this site and present it is less than what we're spending now.
How much is it?
Oh, $300 or, it wasn't much. And right now, we're up around six or something, four or five.
You can say 9,600 sounds like a lot, but really, it's not. I had a chance to look at the site as a demo, and it's fantastic. And I was just involved in another organization looking at a website too, and the estimates were all 16 to 25,000, and the sites were no better. In fact, most of them were not as good as the one we're looking at.
And what really gained our attention on this is as the medical school happens, we are going to be part of a more effective way to present not just our community but our area, because there's going to be a lot of new people in town, and we want to present ourselves to prospective businesses and in investors as a community that's in touch with things and that wants to think and wants to make things happen.
I think this is one of the best things the Chamber can offer and facilitate for its members too, for small businesses in town to be able to have that web presence and a template to walk them through it, I think is really worth a lot.
And we probably should have presented a current website in its state as it is tonight on the screen. I apologize for that, but it is a whole new dynamic look. And by the way, we're not asking the Chamber to pay for a third of the cost, because the EDA represents our local businesses, and the city kind of represents the EDA and itself. So it's kind of a...
Geez, where's the EDA getting all this money?
Apparently, we're getting more money this year.
Mark, how is medical school?
The last update I got in the medical school was that it is expected to open in the fall of 2019. And they're pretty solid on that. They
sound pretty positive.
Sounds very positive, yes. And we can talk off camera if you like, but
The long-range plan with this, Phil's plan anyway, is a lot of the other cities in the footprint of the medical school or Aspire or whatever, do the same thing. Winthrop has jumped, Winthrop is first, which is awesome, I think.
We offered to step up and kind of be that first example of what a community can do, and we hope that Gibbon and Gaylord and Arlington has a pretty good website right now. And others, you know, I'll follow suit, and that will raise everybody's image, and that raises the area's image. And it's an effective, cost-effective way to really enhance the website.
I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Was motion made?
Second.
Seconded. Go ahead and approve payment of half the website, approximately $4,800 on the city side. Is there any further discussion? Any further discussion? If not, proceed to vote. All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed, same sign.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You want to do your report right away?
I can. I have to get it.
I guess.
You know what? Oh, are you going to do yours right away?
If you like, I can, or I can wait.
Well, that's what's next anyway. Not
no,
you.
No, no, we've got the resolution approving the variance request.
I'll go ahead and do that. And here to go along with it.
Okay, let's do the variance request then. Go ahead.
So Mike and Sue Anderson had applied to the city for two variances relating to a request to build a fence on their property. Right now, our fence ordinance says that your fence can only be 6 feet high, and then when you're in a corner lot, the corner part can only be 4 foot high due to safety reasons. So what they've asked for is one variance from the corner height restriction, and then a second variance to allow the total fence to be 8 feet high. So that variance request was heard by the Planning Commission. A public hearing was held. Ultimately, the Planning Commission recommended that the corner height variance be granted, but the total height going from 6 to 8 not be granted. The Planning Commission just felt that 8 feet would be too high for that area and aesthetically would not fit into the area. You have a resolution before you that adopts the Planning Commission recommendation of granting one variance and denying the other. I have, however, written it to address the statutory criteria for granting a variance. There are 5 criteria that you have to analyze when determining whether or not to grant a variance. Regarding the corner height restriction, all the criteria, in my opinion, are met, and that's set forth in the resolution. However, in my opinion, when it comes to going from 6 feet to 8 feet, is that there's one, all criteria except one are met. And that criteria is that there must be unique circumstances present with the property that is not created by the landowner in order for a variance to be appropriate. Here, the landowner is saying that, or cited to the Planning Commission, that the need for the variance is to hide their vehicles from the public. In my opinion, this is a need that's created by their own actions and are not related to the circumstances with the property. Therefore, in my opinion, that criteria is not met, and because it's not met, that variance needs to be denied.
Are there any questions by the council? We had tabled it last month to get that information.
Yeah, we have it.
I'll entertain a motion if there's no person.
So does the three-car variance or?
No, that would still apply to them.
It still applies to them, right?
Even with the fence.
Even with the fence.
Yep.
Okay, there's a motion made. Is there a second?
Yeah, they were trying to get around that.
Second.
And a second. Is there any further discussion? Any further discussion? Now we'll proceed to vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Going to go to city administrator report.
Okay, was a busy month. The Rural Child Care Initiative met. They're having their town hall meeting on the 16th. If any of you would like to go, let me know. You have to RSVP. I am planning on going, and I'm also bringing a former daycare provider with me to help be part of the discussion. I think it'll be a good discussion. I think it's a need we have in Sibley County, so I'm hoping we can work something out with that. The Sibley County Economic Development Group also met this month. They talked about the town hall meeting, the progress on the medical school. Mark kind of updated you on that, and upgrading the web presence. Julie and I attended the league regional meeting in New Ulm. The topics discussed were communicating change to your community, bright ideas and innovation, technology trend issues and resources, strengthening trust in communities, and the legislative update. I do have more information if anybody would like it from my desk. It was a great informational day. Yeah, they usually have pretty good regional meetings for pretty good topics. Kelly, Mark, and I met with Gary to begin discussion on the full-time county attorney issue. I met with Shannon to discuss financing for the next two infrastructure projects in 2019 and 2021. I haven't had a chance to sit down and crunch those numbers yet, but I'm hoping to at some point, maybe hopefully before the end of the year. Joe and I attended a meeting in Mankato put on by the MPCA to discuss phosphorus levels, trading credits, and chloride issues. The only one that really pertains to us right now is the chloride. I've invited the MPCA to come visit with us. They're coming December 1st at 10 a.m. They're bringing a crew down. Yeah, I'm a little nervous about that, but I think it'll be a good discussion. We are not in compliance with our chloride levels, so there are some options we have available to us for the near future, but we need to start planning long range how we're going to address that issue. And that will probably fold into our future planning with infrastructure as well. I attended MMPA for Pete this month. They're working on long-term planning as well, and the public summary is included in your packet. It was a pretty short meeting. They missed you, Pete. I attended the Sibley County Library Board meeting with Julie. I think that is going in the right direction. I think we got everything worked out, I hope.
We'll see. Follows through.
Yeah, that's the tricky part. But I have it on my calendar now, so I'm going to be a little more squeaky. Good. So the new walking path is done in the park, and it looks great. Oscar's going to plant seeds, so it will, a little over budget.
They put that in so you could walk to work, and now you're saying you're not going to go there anymore.
The Alumni Association wants to donate some benches, and I think did they get a hold of you? They were going to get a hold of you and Lyle, and I talked to Mary Renner, and I put it on my calendar for the spring to set up a meeting to discuss where we will put all the benches that they want to give us. So
somebody may have left me a message about that now that I think about it, but it didn't connect that.
Yeah,
that's what it was about.
Well, we're not really going to address it till the spring, so we have time. The specifications have been distributed to all the local contractors for the pavilion. We gave them a deadline of January 15th, thinking most of them are busy with roofing work yet, so we'll see what kind of prices we get in for that at that time. A couple other things. Lisa Hughes with Deed is coming tomorrow to talk to me, and Dana, the city administrator, and Gibbon is coming over too, and we're going to talk about economic development stuff and kind of inform us a little bit more of what we can do for our cities and as far as that goes. November 16th is the Business After Hours Chamber event from 5 to 7 at Hans, and you are all invited. So that's it.
Okay, we'll move on to
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, do you all have a copy of this? Did you print one? Okay.
Yes.
A couple of them have already been addressed tonight, so I'm going to skip the city website unless you have any questions. However, Pete, I would like to answer your question. Pete?
Yep.
Where does the EDA get its money? 6 years ago, a DFA took out a $240,000 loan that had federal monies attached to it and also state monies. We worked out a deal with Deed, the Department of Employment and Economic Development, that the loan payments from that money be come back to the city of Winthrop, and that in itself wasn't that was kind of part of that loan program. But we also found a way to have that money come back to the city of Winthrop without any loan restrictions. Most federal money comes with pages and pages of, you have to do this, you have to do this, you have to do this, but we kind of wash this money legally through the system, and we ended up with about $140,000 cash. And since we got that money, we have started a revolving loan fund where we loan out money to local businesses and people, and they pay us back at lower interest rates. So we've taken that $140,000 that we've gotten, and we've kind of maintained our own with it. We lose a little because we do different projects like the website and stuff, but that's really where that money came from. I kind of caught me off guard the first time around, so I just kind of wanted to answer you on the second time around. Regarding AAA manufacturing, we continue to work with Wes Anderson and his brother and mom to expand his operations here in Winthrop. I believe the street work has been done, right, Jenny? I was out there today. There's a big patch.
Yeah, I think Jerpy's was here last week.
Right. So we continue to work closely on that. The communities of Arlington, Gaylor, Gibbon, and Winthrop have selected ADMARC to do a housing study. We have received a $5,000 grant to help in that cost. All four towns did from AgStar, and so our cost will be about $3,500. The EDA is paying for that, and we are in the process of finalizing an MOU between the four towns on the housing study. We expect that study to be completed late spring, early summer. And then I won't go over to the third one. So if you have any questions, are there any questions?
Yeah, for your purchase.
There you go.
We all know what that
is. Mr. Mayor, I have one more item I'd like to address. I have a letter addressed to you, and I'm going to read it. This letter is my notice to the city that I plan to retire effective December 31st. The last 8-plus years in Winthrop have provided me a wonderful opportunity to not only work with two good mayors and more city councils and more good city councils, but amazing staff, well-meaning residents, and friends to make our community a better place. I hope we have all managed to make some progress. Thank you, me.
Thank you.
And put up with.
Thank you very much, Mark.
Do you want it or should I file it?
No, it's official.
Yeah. You touched it, it's official.
Yeah. On a serious note, though, Mark, thank you for all the years.
Yeah, I
maybe you don't always see eye to eye, but you know what? You are a mover, you are a shaker. Things happen.
And right back at you, it's been a great opportunity for me. It really has. I've enjoyed the hell out of it. So.
All right.
You're not leaving town, are you?
No.
Good. City Legal Counsel.
I have nothing, Mr. Mayor.
All right. I'm glad to hear that. Water and sewer?
I'm going to run for county commissioner.
Don't look at me for that.
Oh, yes. Street?
No, I got
nothing. You got nothing? Well, that cracks nothing going on here. Did you have anything on the other PA?
No, I didn't.
Pardon? There is a statement in there she put in. Jenny went for me.
I know she went to, but did you want to talk?
I think Jenny would probably, I don't know, I wasn't there. There's a lot of future planning going on, and there's a lot of stuff that goes on that we're not really privileged to say.
That's why I didn't want to say a lot, because I don't know what I can say and what I can't say. So okay. I did, one of the things, and this is just me, we don't have the most, you know, Green Step anymore. What is it? Energy Choice customers.
Yeah.
And so I've kind of made it a goal to have the most. So
it's kind of like NASA, huh, Pete? It's all.
No, we just want your buck a month for green power. That's
yep,
all.
Yep.
Whatever.
All right. Fire Chief, was there anything? I don't think.
They're still moving forward with the house burn. Roger's going to get the asbestos out of it, the house. And.
All right. Was there anything? Ambulance? Anything, please?
No, sir. I will be here on the 20th.
All right.
Oh, good.
Yes.
Thank awesome.
Bring
your guns.
Yes.
Kelly?
Yes.
When is that house burn?
We haven't scheduled
yet.
Oh, because I got disconnected.
Well, you should do that soon, because you'll forget.
All right.
And get the trees trimmed.
I would think they'd need that shed before they burn.
Cable commission, everything?
Huh?
It won't hurt.
All marks in the...
Oh, well, right.
I wasn't at the meeting.
Water.
We're still working on, I know Mark has been in contact with some other people to upgrade our equipment here, because the estimate that we got from EPA was way high.
I want to keep moving on this. This equipment is, I mean, we need something in here.
So Mark's working on that.
All right.
Are we going to replace, Mr. Mayor, are we going to replace Mark's position?
The administrative committee is currently working on that.
Okay.
At this point, we'll bring that to the full council, our recommendation.
Just the question.
All right, thank you all. And I'm waiting to be entertained with the motion.
So move.
Motion made.
Second.
Second, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
He did tell we're all going to make it.
Motion second.
When they load that money.
Dale and Bob Dale.
They also get all the numbers off the tower.
Yeah, there's some small street.
Those are the two numbers. I just, well, like I said, I tried calling it.